I says to Mabel, I says, listen, that car was already upside down when I got there. And as for his grandma, well, she shouldn't have been mouthing off like that. I mean, what? No, I don't have anything for the sketch yet. I've been thinking about it, but you know how it is. Things had to change and things had to get worked around, and so I'm working on it. God, I'm blown up. I've been doing all kinds of video work this week. I've been doing all kinds of running around, making sure everything gets taken care of, and I haven't had time to take care of it, so I'm gonna get tired just talking about it with you. So I think I'm gonna let you go. Yeah, all right. Yeah, I'll talk to you later. Oh, man. God, it's time for a little siesta. Maybe I can come up with something. Oh, yeah. Freddy, what are you doing here, man? What's going on? What's the gimmick?
I heard you wanted a sketch, bitch.
No, Freddy, you got me all wrong, man. That's not the kind of sketch I was looking for. I'm talking about a movie, man.
That's not how this works.
Well, okay, if we're going to go that route, oh, Jesus, man, if we're doing all this, don't I at least get a last meal, a last request of some kind?
Yeah, it's been a slow Halloween season, I suppose.
Well... Just stay there. Don't go anywhere. Oh, jeez. Oh. Hey, Fred. You're from the 80s, right? You like Battletech? You know, the game of armored combat?
Yeah, that's all right, I guess.
The early work was a little too... freaky for the audiences at the time, but when this guy came out in 2019, I think they really came into their own, both commercially and artistically.
The whole box set has a clear, crisp redesign, filled with the kind of consummate professionalism that really gives the whole thing a big boost.
It's been compared to Robotech and Gundam model building, but I think Battletech has a far more unique, rugged sense of individuality.
Hey, Tuckleston.
Yes, Freddy?
Why are there copies of record sheets all over the place? You have a little dog? Like one of those little chiweenies or something?
No, Freddy.
Is that a raincoat?
Yes, it is! Let's get some tunes going, huh? Oh, loading Spotify. In 2020, Catalyst released this, the Clan Invasion, the most accomplished box set. I think their undisputed masterpiece is the Kickstarter Wave 2 miniatures. With mechs so sexy, most people probably don't think about the game mechanics. But they should, because it's not just about the pleasures of camaraderie and the importance of friends, it's also a personal statement about the brand itself. Hey, Fred! Try breaking into one of my future dreams now, you freaking sneaky little bitch! Ha! You sneaky bitch!
That's not how this works, bitch.
What do you mean it's not how this works? This is my dream, isn't it? Were you telling me I can't do whatever I want in my own damn dream?
Not anymore, bitch. I'm in charge.
What? Okay? You want me to play Battletech? Okay? it. You couldn't get the saw guy? You know, let's play a game. Was he double booked in someone else's dream? Get him?
I got a saw for you right here.
Whoa, guys, whoa. Why y'all gotta be so stinking macho all the time? This ain't the 80s anymore. I just calm down. Get this thing out of my face. Calm down. Fine. Just calm down. So what you're telling me is, I play this game, and I win, then I just get to walk away scot-free. That's it. That's what you're telling me.
That's a big yeah, bitch.
Well, what choice do I have? Let's roll the bones, then.
This dream is over. I've seen what you've done.
No,
we're
no!
We're in charge now, bitch!
No! No, Freddy! No! I guess I must have been dreaming. Oh. Whew. I did all that running in that dream, though. God. Pretty thirsty, Urban. Carl Urban. Better go get me a drink. Oh, parched. Oh.
I've been playing BattleTech almost as long as I've been alive, and it's my passion to bring the tabletop experience to as many people as possible. I want to have a great game with you! I'm Tuck Davian, and together with the members of the Tulsa BattleTech League, we're out on the open road, looking for players with guts to join us once again and feel the DACA on BattleBound!
Good evening, BattleTech fans. It's that time of year again, and as is our tradition, we're going to take ourselves on another trip off the beaten path. Tonight, we aren't traveling down the well-worn routes of what is, but instead through the uncharted reaches of what could be to answer the question, What if?
Access.
What if the rules of reality don't always apply? What if, for one night, the impossible were possible? It's Halloween. Grab your lanterns and join us as we explore Tuckstavian's Weird War Tales.
The Rickety Ratchet Saloon, Solaris 7, 12th October, 3055.
Now, Sarah Shane was the best Zeus pilot I'd ever seen. Now, Zeus ain't exactly a machine what strikes fear or commands respect on its name alone like the Atlas or the Awesome. Sarah was a master of using what she had and making it work. Word around the campfire was one night down on some bayou at a voodoo ceremony, her father had called up the devil to challenge him after being dispossessed in the battle for Mallory's world. A man that desperate will try anything. They say old man Shane outfoxed the devil and won his battle mech. Of course it was a Zeus. Who would suspect it? Named it the Devil's Trumpet, partly as a joke and partly on account of just how the sound of it coming seemed to be enough to make a mech warrior wish he hadn't climbed out of his rack that day. It passed to his daughter when he was killed on a mission out in the periphery. Some kind of freak accident, they said. And from then on, it was the only mech she'd touch. Sure, it may only be a Zeus, but behind the controls, nobody or nothing could hit the shots or make the plays she could. Others got better known. No one ever got better. Only she knew from what happened to her old man that she had to be careful. Push too hard, reach too far, and the thundering of the guns on that Satan mech could call up a demon from hell. You know what they say about deals with the devil, don't you? Even when you win, you lose. Beelzebub's got his tricks, I guess. Well, one hot night in 3050, same as her pops, she was pushing hard, reaching far, and they say Sarah Shane did just that. Of course, we know it was the clans what showed up during the raid she was in. Whatever happened, no one heard from her ever again. Some say the demon flew back to hell with her in tow, but the kicker of it all is somehow that mech got lost along the way. Since then, everyone and their grandparents went out looking for that rusty old bucket of bolts. Some wanted to destroy it for religious reasons, some wanted to ferret it away in their personal collection or sell it off and retire. They even say others wanted to restore the cursed thing, take it out on another damn fool crusade for fortune and glory. Only whatever was attached to those endeavors always seemed to go south. Treasure hunters would go out and never come back. Even old Cranston Snored wouldn't touch it with your hands, and whether he was scared or not, no one knows. Some say it was found, passed around from pilot to pilot. For them what possessed it, nobody or nothing could hit the shots or make the plays they could. Like clockwork, it always wound up getting lost again somewhere along the way. Headlines always the same. Reclusive scavenger claims, I have the key to the devil's trumpet. A lot of guys claim they went up against it. They know the sound of that mech, they say. Man's ears don't forget something that special, or mistake when other men try to replicate it for the shock value. Not that sound. Nothing like the soulless brawls you see here on the game world. Got a dangerous sound. Not just good, driven. Only a sound a man who'd risk calling demons would make. Not many men like that, but over the years, once in a while. Yeah, I've heard that story, and I know why you come around here telling it. To hear me say it's so.
Online. Accessing.
Welcome back, BattleTech fans. Let's have a look at tonight's game by the numbers.
Accessing.
Tech fans, tonight, the players representing two groups of treasure hunters each vie for the coveted trophy of the fabled Devil's Battle Mech. However, what the players don't know is that not only does the machine carry an impressive set of weapons, but an insane amount of special powers, making for a combination the players may not find themselves able to resist. The question will be, who will get to it first, and can they stay their hand once they realize they have access to the raw power of Beelzebub himself?
Sends the beast with wrath because he knows the time is short. Let him who hath understanding reckon the number of the beast, for it is a human number. Its number is 666.
The time, the future past, the place, the asphalt. The promise of power that only a deal with the devil himself could make compelled two groups of rogue treasure hunters to a remote location, each looking to capture the storied potential of the king of the bottomless pit. Despite each team being shocked at the presence of a competitor for the prize, the Relic Raiders were able to take control of the initiative. However, the initial shock seemed to wear off almost instantly for the treasure hunters. To them, this mission was paramount, and a little extra heat would not keep them out of the kitchen as they started out by pushing toward the most direct route to their goal. As the Relic Raiders followed, a jockeying for position was beginning to take shape as they felt like they were behind the eight ball right out of the gate. Both hunters and raiders made a concerted effort to stick together, each of their teams taking up what they felt like was the best positions in order to start their respective drives toward their shared end goal. Only the treasure hunter's commander ventured out into an open field position, angling for a nearly direct path toward their final destination, while the raiders stuck together like glue on the battlefield's southwest side. Both commanders knew their enemies would fight fiercely, and there would be a hard rain to come before either of the two of them would let up. The only question at the time was who would be the first to find an opening, and who would be the first to exploit it. The Devil's Trumpet waited patiently.
Well, through dust, through clouds, I see miles.
The hunters wrested control of the initiative away from the raiders, and the timing for them could not have been more perfect. In the superior tactical position, the hunters watched as the enemy commander's victor pressed forward, but it was nothing they weren't already prepared for. Responding directly, the hunter's commander bolted his cyclops up and toward the prize, looking to put the pressure on the raiders and hopefully catch them looking. For their part, the raiders felt locked out of the race as their bandersnatch pilot made his way to join his commander and looked on with concern as yet another enemy mech strode forward with purpose, mirroring the same movements as they. As the raiders' guillotine pilot could do nothing more than stick with the group, there was naught for them to do but watch the pilot of the faster Shadowhawk speeding up and angling himself into a direct attack vector to take possession. The tension in the air could be cut with a knife as the Centurion pilot completely forgot to engage his triple strength Miamer as his concentration was stolen away by watching the much heavier Falconer take up a supporting role next to his smaller comrade. The two teams could still not draw a bead on one another, and the raiders had a feeling this was on purpose, as the hunters were looking to draw them in and bog them down while they went to take control of the Devil's battle mech. The hunters would keep the initiative, and the controllers of the hulking behemoths of old prepared to lean into their final lap on a collision course with destiny. The raiders charged toward the prize, with their bandersnatch pilot firmly leading the way, looking to get into a better firing position and finally put eyes on their enemy. Naturally, the hunters kept their strategy of cautious advancement going, as their eagerness to begin combat was not as white-hot as their opponents seemed to be. As the enemy grasshopper had moved deeper into the city, the raiders' commander slowly pressed forward, his jump jets lighting the way toward his destination beyond the trees. For the hunters, dignity laced the oil in their veins. Honor for the asphalt. The classic frame of the Cyclops charged forward headfirst, relaying telemetry and sending orders out over the comms. As he predicted, the Raiders' guillotine pilot kept by his bulkier comrade in the Bandersnatch, hoping strength in numbers would be the puzzle piece they were looking for. But then, a new hope would be gambled on. Who would toss such a hand as this? Lighting his jets in a plume of incandescent fire, the pilot inside the Falconer would land, guns akimbo, to face down his foes and guard the play his comrade was soon to make. With the Raider's Centurion pilot having nothing left but to meekly follow his fellows and hope for the best, the Hunter's path was now clear. The wheels of their machinations turned, howling as the Shadowhawk pilot blazed a trail toward the infernal machine formerly belonging to the Lord of Terror. The time had finally come, and the long-deserted highways would once again bear witness as missile, autocannon, and laser fire from both teams flashed across the blacktop like a beacon of possibility. Though sadly, the jury would remain out, as for most of even these, there would be no unique affection. Only a lone report from the Shadowhawk's shoulder-mounted cannon glanced off the arm of the Bandersnatch, and despite the minor nature of the damage, the move nonetheless made the intent of the Hunters clear and gave the Raiders pause for caution. The Raiders were able to retake control of the initiative, but with their team being so far behind the 8-ball, the question was it too little, too late? The Raiders tried to put this question out of their collective minds as they watched the commander and his Cyclops continue his forward charge, going up the city's north side. While the Bandersnatch pilot pushed with all speed to bring the brunt of his weapons into better firing position, the man inside the Hunter's Falconer kept up with his defensive tactics, covering the approach vector of his fellows by using his machine's powerful jump jets. For the Raiders, their commander was suffering similar issues to that of his cohort, as his machine was simply not fast enough to make a going concern of presenting himself as a real threat, hoping instead to make it in time to prevent the Hunters from getting a pilot inside the prize. As the Grasshopper pilot pulled into a final approach vector, it became apparent that the Hunters were the superior tacticians in this instance, but the Raiders nonetheless persisted. Their guillotine pilot kept by his fellows as the Hunters encircled the buildings to the east. With the thrum of the Devil's mech humming in his ear, the Shadowhawk pilot made his play. Like the folded metal of a forged blade, he strode with solid purpose, his path strewn with the infinite possible outcomes of what lay ahead. To the mech he leapt, a charge of apprehension afoot in the wild atmosphere and the gravity of the situation pulling at his soul. His teammates now had to keep the Raiders off of his tail so he could make the switch, and the Hunters steeled themselves as both teams once again prepared for cold steel, drawing cold blood. The Centurion quickly followed, and the stage was set. The Shadowhawk pilot powered off his machine as the two commanders leveled their guns at one another. While he scrambled down the side of the 55-ton Striker, his commander laid down covering fire with a blistering spread of missiles and a Gauss rifle slug. Despite all shots flying wide of their intended targets, the Hunter's commander had accomplished his goal: cover the egress of his teammate. Now, the final piece to the puzzle would be keeping their tactics tight and keeping the Raiders out of their face until the switch could be made. For the Raiders, the mood was about to change. Despite keeping control of the initiative, the Raiders were now in over their heads. The Shadowhawk pilot had made it to the Devil's Machine and was now frantically clambering up the side. The Guillotine pilot made a break for the Devil's mech, trying to get an eye on what was happening, but the tall defilade kept him from his goal. Meanwhile, the Hunter's commander was barreling forward, seeing the heavier mechs making a break for his fellow, and he trained his guns on the would-be assailant. The Bandersnatch pilot was the next raider to try and get the Devil's mech in his sights, but his hopes were dashed on the rocky surface it sat behind as the Shadowhawk pilot inched ever closer to the cockpit. The Hilltop was now setting itself up to be a meat grinder, as both the Grasshopper and Victor pilots moved into closer weapons range, for when the marrow of dignity is sucked from the bones of humanity, hatred prevails in the minds of men. Completing the Hunter's macabre maneuvers, their Falconer pilot pulled his machine to the base of the hill the Shadowhawk was shielded behind as he watched his comrade throw open the cockpit doors of the Devil's Trumpet and slam it shut behind him. With the Centurion pilot still struck by fear, his triple-strength Miamer was as cold as ice, and as such, he could not make it to more than the foot of the hill, frustratingly unable to strike at the Shadowhawk pilot, who was soon to be a Shadowhawk pilot no more. The raiders were furious. With violence in their hearts, they trained all their weapons on the one target they could see, the Cyclops driven by the Hunter's commander. The raiders focused fire and bombarded the 90-ton command mech with a hellish fusillade as the smell of brimstone from their guns filled the air. The raiders bore down on the Hunter's commander with great vengeance and furious anger. There would be no quarter for the interlopers. The old school played for keeps. The Hunter's commander managed to connect with the Bandersnatch with a lone Gauss rifle slug from the 90-ton bruiser, but this would be the last report for the weapon. As the raiders gored the Cyclops, the Bandersnatch pilot returned the favor and opened his enemy up like a tin can, causing the charged capacitors of the rifle to explode with a thundering cacophony. The neural feedback was simply too much. The pilot fell silent, and as his vision dimmed, his battle mech soon followed. As it met the dirt with a sickening thud, the commander suffered further injury, and his comrades had only done moderate damage to the Bandersnatch for all their combined efforts. However, the pilot formerly of the Shadowhawk was firmly in place inside the Devil's mech. He started up the ignition sequence and his eyes widened as the heads-up display came to life while he looked on. How he would put this machine to use raced through his head, but one thing was for certain, standing in the dark was for the shadows.
Reactor online. Sensors online. Weapons online. Systems nominal.
All right, Jeff, you have taken control of the Devil's Trumpet. The battle mech formerly belonging to old Beelzebub himself has the following spooky powers. You may repair up to 15 points of damage per turn of either armor or structure as long as the mech has actually taken damage that turn. Can't hide out and then just fully repair yourself. It doesn't work that way. But you can't repair more than half of the armor damage in any given location at the time that you do this. So if you have an arm that has 10 points of damage on it, you can't repair more than 5 of that. But the internal structure does not suffer this limitation. Okay? However, you must always give precedence to the internal structure before you do anything in the armor of that given location. So if you have even 1 point of damage in the internal structure, then you can't repair any armor until the internal structure is taken care of. But you can repair as much internal structure points as you feel like in any given location.
Up to 15 points.
Up to 15 points.
Right.
The Devil's mech cannot take through armor criticals. So somebody rolls snake eyes on you, they're going to have to re-roll that. And that means they'll get the next hit location that they would normally roll. So if they roll a snake eyes, a through armor critical, it don't count. They re-roll again till they get something other than a through armor critical. Now, the last thing that it can do is it can add +1 to its movement in exchange for paying +1 to fire on any target that it shoots at for that turn.
So it's a 3-walk, 5-run, but you can go for 6. You'll just be paying +1 to shoot.
And the skills are equal to the pilot of the guy that just jumped into it.
Correct. So you have a 3-gunner, 4 pilot in there. That is the power of the devil. Now remember the legend. You push too hard, you go too far. Some other stuff might or might not happen. You'll just have to find out. Oh, and by the way, here's the fun part.
You don't get to control the devil's battle mech. I do!
Don't spoil the big surprise. You won't believe your eyes when you see Nature Trail to Hell. Nature Trail to Hell. Nature Trail to Hell in 3D. Nature Trail to Hell.
The Raiders kept the initiative for themselves, and they knew they'd soon need all the help they could get. Unable to keep his unholy desires in check, the hunter inside the devil's trumpet blitzed it out from the hiding spot it had previously occupied for years, now with a new commander at the helm. The raiders, not being privy to the information the devil's trumpet pilot had, moved away cautiously, starting with their commander inside the victor. With the courage of knowing what their teammate now possessed, the grasshopper pilot moved into a support position and dared the bandersnatch pilot to make a move. It was a dare he'd have no choice but to take, as the pilot followed his commander's lead and continued the backpedaling movement the team had thus far embraced. Though the enemy commander's mech remained motionless on the ground, the guillotine pilot was struck by the fear of the unknown. He remained motionless and unmoving as he did nothing but watch the hunter's falconer pilot ascend the summit of the hill his partner had previously used for defilade, and by the time the guillotine pilot realized the falconer was on a collision course, it was too late to make a move. With the Raider Centurion pilot moving up in defense of his comrade, the stage was once again set for another bloodbath, a harbinger of hard times to come. The pilot inside the Devil's mech could not help himself and unleashed the full power of his machine. The frame of the victor was rocked by the barrage as his snub-nosed PPC melted armor away and his LRM pack locked on. However, his heavy Gauss rifle could not connect, as he was joined shortly in his fusillade by his fellow in the grasshopper, and the combined fire sent the victor's frame wavering just such that the devastating shell sailed past. The Raider's commander was thrown off kilter from the combined effort of his enemies, and as such, his shots flew wide as he used all his spare concentration to keep his machine upright. The guillotine pilot was locked now in a ferocious struggle of his own. As the enemy falconer drew ever closer, he let fly with every weapon he could offer. But despite connecting with his shots and having aid from his cohort inside the Centurion, the 75-ton brawler's course was not thrown off. As his compatriot inside the Bandersnatch blew massive holes in the Devil's mech with lasers, missiles, and his sizable autocannons, a scream came out over the comm line as the Falconer collided with the guillotine in a gnarly clash that sent the lighter of the pair toppling off the hillside he stood atop. The high-tech weapons of tomorrow would take a back seat, as the art of the switchblade and the chain could still paint a gruesome picture all on their own. The guillotine pilot crashed to the dirt, and despite the pilot avoiding any serious injury, he looked up through his cockpit glass just in time to see the holes shot by his lance-mate in the Bandersnatch closing right before his eyes. Inside the Cyclops, the hunter's commander remained unmoving, and his ears were still deaf to the pleas of his teammates. This was made worse by the fact that the Raiders still controlled the initiative, but the pilot inside the Devil's Trumpet seemingly could not care any less. He lit out into the gap by a nearby stream, knowing the Raiders were simply not prepared for the hate he would soon visit upon them. The eagerness of the move spelled hubris to the guillotine pilot. He rose as if it were a maneuver he'd completed 1,000 times before, and pressed his machine to its very limit in order to gain the coveted 6 o'clock firing position on the Devil's Trumpet. The hunter's misfortune continued as the Grasshopper pilot ran at full speed to defend his fellow against an attack from the guillotine. He zigged when he should have zagged, and skidded along the pavement, landing in a crumpled heap off to the side. While the Centurion pilot took the Raiders' strategy to the next level in an attempt to box the Falconer in and restrict its pilot's movement, he was soon joined by his commander in the Victor, who brazenly strode forward, also looking to put the Devil's mech squarely within his crosshairs. Shocked at the turn of events taking place before him, the Falconer pilot could muster nothing more than to backpedal and try to keep a firing position on the Raiders, the confidence from his previous maneuver having all but evaporated. His brow further furrowed with worry and concern as the Bandersnatch pilot, not out of the fight yet, plowed forward, his gun still smoking from his previous sortie against the Devil's mech, menacingly staring down the Falconer pilot on his hilltop hideout. The Bandersnatch pilot let slip the dogs of war on his enemy in the Falconer. It was a pummeling befitting the machine's name, as every single shot connected, tearing into the Falconer's gyro, but the Falconer would not be outdone. As the plates underneath his feet shook like a man who looked forward to the worst, he teamed with his cohort in the Devil's mech, the pair damning the Bandersnatch with a withering burst of punishing fire that sent the monstrous mech to the scrap heap for good. This Pyrrhic victory cost him his footing, and he joined his two other lancemates on the ground. While this nightmare exchange was playing itself out, the other three Raiders all trained their weapons on the Devil's mech. They tore into it with an unmatched fury, but the Devil's Trumpet continued to play the song. As the Grasshopper's weapons flew past the guillotine, the Raider's commander watched on in horror as the wounds in the Devil's mech closed up right before his eyes. As the rest of the hunters foundered, it seemed that the power of the Devil extracted a terrible price from the rest of them. Though the pilot inside continued on, the hunters were being drained, and they were losing. The hunter's commander finally awoke to the sounds of unadulterated carnage unfolding all around him. This seemed to bring the initiative back to the hunters, but the tables had definitely turned during his time away. As the 90-ton assault mech stirred, the Raider's commander was looking to seize opportunity. He leapt to the top of a nearby building, and he hoped that this maneuver would be sufficient to keep the Devil's mech in his sights. The horrors that the hunter's commander had awoken to was more than enough to convince him to beat a hasty retreat, as becoming dispossessed was not what he'd signed up for. The Raiders decided to let him go, as they had much larger fish to fry. The Centurion pilot charged up to continue to fire on the Devil's mech, and the pilot inside the mech of the Stygian Snake decided his prize was worth more than the heads of his enemies. He moved toward an escape vector, but the guillotine pilot would have none of it. The Raiders had realized the power and the promise of what must be traded in order to wield it, and decided it could not be allowed to wander off. The Falconer pilot continued to flop and flail, his severely damaged gyro working against him, or at least so it seemed. His fellow in the Grasshopper was able to fight against whatever dark forces bound them, and he made his play to give hell to his enemies, hoping he could somehow turn their horrible luck around. The guillotine pilot continued to bring the Raiders' fury against the Devil's mech, chewing away with laser and missile fire, but the pilot inside drew once again on the dark forces he controlled, sending a snub-nosed particle cannon blast directly into the cockpit of his assailant. Though his target lived through the blast, the heat from the blow sent him careening into dark, black unconsciousness, and the guillotine pilot stood motionless against the havoc being wrought around it. However, as the fires of perdition giveth, the blackness of darkness taketh away. Their commander on the run, the Hunter's Falconer pilot tried his best to give as good as he got, but the sole medium laser he managed to land on the Raider Centurion was a paltry, burnt offering. Watching on in a blind panic as the Raider's commander bathed the grasshopper in righteous fire, and his comrade in the Devil's machine drawing demonic power from the depths below to their detriment, he could stand no more. While the Centurion crashed to the dirt under a savage barrage emanating from the grasshopper, the man behind the controls of the Falconer pulled his eject lever. The bolts popping echoed in his ears, and the smell of sulfur engulfed his nostrils, and he sailed far above the battlefield to fight no longer. Thus began the Showcase Showdown. The treasure hunters had gone from riding high to being laid low in a matter of moments. The Raiders' grip on the initiative was firm and unyielding, and the betrayal of ideals was taking shape. With a burst of demonic speed that belied the machine's size, the pilot inside the Devil's mech made a break for an exit, and with the pounding the Centurion pilot had just endured, he could see the value in a timely escape as well. As the Hunter's Grasshopper pilot made a beeline for his comrade in the Devil's mech, looking to escape with his life, the Raider's commander smelled blood. He leapt his victor into point-blank range and prepared to give the Grasshopper his best, as he knew he had no hope of catching the Devil's trumpet. Perhaps he could cause the pilot to change course and come back to save his compatriot. Working in tandem, the Grasshopper pilot and his fellow inside the Devil's mech laid into the motionless guillotine, capitalizing on the pilot's unconsciousness, drowning it in relentless and unforgiving fire, while the pilot had no ability to fight against it. The guillotine fell to the ground, flatly, and its pilot was further injured in the collision as a result. However, the Raider's commander would not let this affront go unavenged and blasted away at his cohort's would-be assassin, leveling severe punishment to the Grasshopper and shredding two of its leg actuators in the process. He thanked the gods of combat for his luck, as his partner in the Centurion had joined him in this action, only to come up completely dry. The Grasshopper pilot checked the radar feed on his heads-up display as he plotted his escape. What was this? The pilot inside the Devil's battle mech plotted what he thought was to be his final course, though he may have been far more right than he knew. He possessed the Devil's machine. How could he not take what he now rightfully owned? He had bought it with another man's blood. The Grasshopper pilot's heart nearly stopped as he saw the answer to his question writ large on the battlefield before him. Six new mechs entered the fray, each purposely painted a bleached white and bearing no markings or unit insignia. From whence they had come, he didn't know. He knew only now where he and the rest of those fighting to take possession of power beyond their knowledge or scope were soon to be on their way to. He and the other pilots stood, transfixed, staring with disbelief and horror as the same thought simultaneously occurred to them all. Push too hard, reach too far, and they found out the legends were true. Some say the strange unit was already there looking for the same prize, and it was the bellowing of the cannon carried by the devil's mech that alerted them to the location. Others say the furious sounds of fighting is what tipped off the interlopers. Of course, others say Comstar was just late to the party and would have shown up anyway. Where that machine is now? Who knows? But yes, I've heard this story before, and I know why you come around here telling it. To hear me say it so. And now, with our story concluded, that brings us to the segment of the show we like to call After the Action.
All right, BattleTech fans, it's after the action time. You know how it is. You know how I do. Got my players in on this with me. We're going to talk about what just happened there. Now, I want to start with you guys. Where do you think that game went versus where you thought it was going when we first started? Talk to me. Tell me everything.
All right, so I honestly thought that once the Devil Mech got into play, I was hosed. Friggin' hosed.
But you kept fighting back. I mean, I expected you to half-hearted play the red line. Oh, well, I'm screwed here. No, dude, you came back. You were just like, I'm putting my boxing gloves on, and we're gonna duke this out. And you drove him back. He drove you back. I couldn't believe it. I thought, you know, even though I was missing with that heavy Gauss rifle so many times, I thought, well, for sure, I've got this gnarly self-repairing mech. I mean, come on. It's like better than a self-cleaning oven. I'm just pow, pow at the guns, and I just couldn't hit with that heavy Gauss rifle to save my life. I fired it maybe 4 times, I think, and I didn't hit with a single one.
Thank goodness.
I mean, you were shooting inside of its minimum range, which just made it super hard. So, I mean, it's kind of understandable. You needed high numbers.
Hey.
Yeah, well, that's what you were doing.
That's the whole reason why I was hugging that mech, because I know one or two shots from that thing on any of my mechs, and I was done.
Yeah, just
toast.
Yeah, and I was just like, well, okay, I know I got this minimum range penalty, right? And I know that I'm sitting here working, but it's a 3-gunner. It's not the worst thing in the world. Maybe if I walk it, or if I, you know, kind of work my way in there, and it was like I was getting up to having to roll 10s at point blank range. So I guess there is a downside to a heavy Gauss rifle.
Absolutely.
After all. So, okay, I know that you're a veteran of this particular gimmick. You were at the Ham-loween game last year,
yeah.
So you know when you go into these things that some fuckery, some bullshit is gonna happen.
That TAC, ignoring the TAC. You're lucky I can't curse on camera.
I just did! Why don't you do it? I literally just did that.
You fucker.
Yeah, this show ain't PG anymore. I've long since evolved past that. Okay, so Jeff.
Yeah.
I know I told you about this ahead of time, but I didn't tell you what the reveal was. I didn't tell you what the superpowers were. I didn't tell you anything except here's what stats the mech has, and that's
it. Right.
So when it came down to the mechanics of how the mech worked, because you're the one who got it.
Right.
How did you feel about that? Was that too overpowered? Or did you feel like, that was all right? Or, you know, what did you exactly think when you saw the design and looked at it and then heard the superpowers?
I thought it was a great construction. I think you put a lot of thought into it, and it did for the game what you designed it to do, which I think was really good. I loved it.
I actually patterned that machine after Alexander Kerensky's Orion. And that thing is just gnarly when you think about the time period where he was fighting with it. It's got a Gauss rifle, a snub-nosed PPC. You know, he's got a bunch of other stuff. And I thought, man, how can I take a Zeus and make it so that it's very similar, so I have an assault class chassis, but I also have access to these crazy guns. And what I did was I also patterned the game mechanics after the movie Christine, Stephen King.
Yes.
The self-repairing car. And I was just like, how can I make this thing look like a 57 Chevy?
Fins.
So that's where that whole thing came from. And I was real happy with how those mechanics turned out. I thought, maybe they're a little on the powerful side. But at the same time, it's the devil.
Yes.
So how can you expect the devil to ride into, you know, something that doesn't have, you know, crazy stuff on it or have spooky, crazy abilities? So, okay.
the reveal at the end. Let's talk about that.
No.
Because you know the story. If you're pushing too hard, if you're reaching too far, you call up a demon from hell. And in the original legend, it was the clans. You know, and everybody said, well, we know what really happened. It wasn't a demon. It was just the clan. But in this case, I was like, well, the first demon was was the clans. Who better than Comstar to be the second one?
What did I say when I first saw that? I paid my HBG bills.
Paid my HBG bills. Wait. And I was like, I already have a level 2 all nice and painted up. And I was like, I just can't wait to see the look on their faces when this whole thing happens. So what did you guys think about the reveal?
It sucked. It really sucked. I mean, I worked, you know, I thought in the beginning of the game, I executed the plan to take the Devil's Mech to perfection. It was just in the after taking the Devil's Mech where everything went south.
He just came back on you like a prize fighter that he had been playing rope-a-dope on you. You know, he came back like Rocky and just two-two, and even though the reveal at the end sucked, it was like I was telling you during the game, you were on your way out anyway.
Right.
He was whipping you, you know, worse than a horse at the Kentucky Derby. Yeah. And there wasn't really going to be any way you could salvage that other than to be like, run away, run away.
I
realized, oh shit, they're getting real close to the edge of the board. I didn't really want to do the reveal, if I'm being honest with you, until like turn 13, because you know, Ham-loween 13.
Yeah.
But in this case, I was like, well, another two turns and these guys will be off the board. And there's no real credible threat here if I wait until the Devil's Battle Mech gets to the very edge of the board. He could just be like, Comstar? Okay, bye. And leave. So I was like, I have to bring in this force to intercept that thing before it has the real solid chance to escape. And with that grasshopper fixing to jump over the mountain there and try to make his escape as well, I was like, that's the spot where I gotta bring him in so they can just tear these guys apart, you know, with super elite pilots or something like that. But okay, let's take a different tack here.
All right.
Going in, what was your strategy knowing that you were there to collect a prize?
Get to that price before he could. I mean, literally, that move in formation because, well, pot shots happen.
Sure.
And if I couldn't get those pot shots, he couldn't get those pot shots. So I was trying to move in formation that way. If I had a throw down, I had my entire force ready to throw down. That didn't happen. And then I had to spread out just to try to make up ground that he ended up covering because he had a couple faster mechs than I did.
I feel like he kind of juked you at the beginning, where he was moving, you were moving in just such a way that those buildings were in his line of sight, or there was a hilltop and he couldn't shoot you, and you were like, don't care, I'm going for this prize right now, that's all I care about.
Yeah.
And you were able to, I don't want to say gerrymander, but that's kind of what I was thinking, to gerrymander your positions to be like, can he see me? No, let's move there. And you didn't ask, you didn't, you know, like, hey, can we check the sight laser? You just did it.
Right.
You know, and I thought that was a fantastic move because every time he stifled you.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting there going, aw, dude, like.
Like, I was itching to get them guns out.
Oh, I know, man.
Sun's out, guns out, I'm ready to throw down, but he played it like boxing, just stick, move, stick, move.
So when you were going into it, is that what you had intended to do, or was that just a happy accident?
A happy accident. I mean, I'm glad it ended up that way. But I mean, I knew. I mean, I was just from where I was. I was just counting it, and I mean, I could see where I wanted to go, and I think I did exactly what I needed to do. You know, up to me claiming the Devil's Mech, I thought I pulled that off perfectly.
You did.
And
you did.
And you know, and I liked how I maneuvered the Cyclops around that one building. I mean, I just had my three heavy guys providing what I thought would be the perfect cover for the collection of the Devil's Mech, which, you know, and I think it was definitely a happy accident that I was exactly where, you know, where that Shadowhawk was. I was exactly 8 movement away from lining, I mean, being right next to the Devil's Mech. I mean, I don't know if I counted that out, but that just worked out perfectly.
But you pulled into that perfect range where you were adjacent to the level 2 mountain,
right,
and Bear's units being on top couldn't see you.
Yeah. Right,
and so,
yeah.
As I said, if they blast you,
right,
that thing is going to fall over because
right,
you're not in it anymore. Your
right,
pilot is escaping to go
right,
take the prize,
yeah,
and that thing goes down, you're going to take a 2-3 story fall, and that's
yeah,
going to, you know, not going to be very good for you.
Yeah, so I mean, you gave me that level 2, I saw that, and it's just like, boom.
I didn't position better.
Yeah, I nailed that part of it, but it
that
went
leads
south
me to my second question, my lead up or follow up question. Mm-hmm. There is, you started out so strong, right?
Right.
And you had great field position,
right,
and you knew exactly what you were doing and where right, you were going and how you were going to do it.
Right.
Where did it fall apart for you?
Losing the Cyclops. Once that Cyclops,
I fell unconscious and then you couldn't wake back up for two turns.
Right.
No, it wouldn't hit hits. It was that Gauss rifle exploding.
Yeah, you internaled me and blew up my Gauss rifle.
Yes.
Which caused you the two pilot hits.
And
You made your first one, but you couldn't make the second one. So you fell unconscious because the
Gauss exploded.
Right, and that third pilot hit after
right,
you fall,
right,
like you just weren't ever able to wake up until
right,
it was too late. By the time
right,
that pilot was conscious again,
right,
so much stuff had happened. So many
yeah,
things had gone wrong by that point.
Right.
And you stood up and was like, I'm crippled. I'd rather keep my mech and my life, thank you. It's time to go.
Yes. Right.
And so that was my strategy. Once he got the Devil's Mech,
yeah,
I was like, all right, what's my best angle on the heaviest bastard out there? And I'm going to blow him the hell up. Because if I could just take away some of the effectiveness of his team, what he's got on the board, I could put myself in a better position.
No, you did right there, and he criticized you at the time.
He
was like,
he
really?
Did.
You're gonna shoot the Cyclops? And I'm like, yes! I'm going to shoot the Cyclops! It's got the least amount of armor out of all of these giant behemoths that you're running.
Right.
And I'm like, fuck yeah, you can take 4 guys on that and blast it.
It has the armor
of a medium mech or lighter heavy.
Right.
So it don't take too many shots to start punching holes in that thing.
Yeah.
And it paid dividends for you when you hit that Gauss rifle and then you fell unconscious.
Right.
You weren't able to have access to him. And then
right,
you had your Shadowhawk gone
right,
the
right,
entire game because
right,
the pilot had climbed out.
Right.
And you didn't go too much longer before the Falconer was in dire straits.
Yeah.
Another solid Gauss rifle of that center torso, and that would have put, you know,
that
a capper
been,
on it.
Yeah,
that would have
been
done.
Right.
And then, okay, here's where I think the Cyclops wasn't the worst thing in the world for you, I think. Yes, I can see how it sucks, but you'd lost that guy, you still had the Devil's Trumpet.
Right.
So if that
right,
were me in that situation,
right,
I'd be like, okay, whatever.
Right.
I still have this. The thing that I think really just bang, put that nail in the coffin for you is when you attempted to stand with the Falconer and went flip, flop, and
right,
you only needed, what, 5?
No, I had
a the gyro hit.
That's what did it for me. I mean, the fact that in that round of fire, he hit my gyro, which, you know, caused me to fall over. I could not stand back up. I mean, there's nothing I could do at that point.
And when, you know, I mentioned to you that it was crippling damage and
right,
gave you your options,
right,
you made a good point where
right,
you said, look, even if I want to escape with this thing, I can stand up, but I run the risk of falling over and
right,
further damaging myself.
Right.
And I could stand, fall,
I mean,
and eventually kill myself.
Right.
Just
right,
on that alone.
I mean, I tried one turn to try that, and I fell twice.
Both times.
And I figured this is just going to keep happening. That gyro hit is just going to keep me from gaining my feet again.
And because you were at the top of that mountain, your pilot couldn't exactly climb out and make it to that fresh, empty Shadowhawk
right,
without his Victor saying,
right,
medium pulse
yeah,
lasers,
boom,
pew, pew, you're dead.
Right. Yes.
So there would have been no getting out of that for you.
Right.
And it sucks to have to be in that situation and you're like, I gotta punch out of this thing.
Right.
But I mean, I completely understand why you did it. But personally, I wouldn't have sweated the loss of that Cyclops. I would have taken that as, that's part of the course.
Yeah.
It would be losing that Falconer.
Right.
I would be like, oh, dude, even though I have this, you know, devil mech over here, what am I left with at that point? You know, I've lost my Falconer. I don't have the Shadowhawk anymore. I don't have the Cyclops. I have my Grasshopper and I have that thing.
Yeah.
And my opponent's only lost his Bandersnatch.
Right.
Which I expected that one to go down as well. It's a neat little, you know, mech, but that XL engine will hose you every time.
Yeah.
And the Bandersnatch is cool and all, but I expected it to die. So when it got destroyed, I said, okay, you're not out of this yet.
No.
You still have all these other things. And you managed to keep those other mechs. And that Centurion was a, you know, just a prize fighter for you.
Yeah, he was. Distance.
And Bear loves the Centurion.
I do. That's,
so that's
my
why
favorite
I gave
medium.
Him that lance. Because he loves the Centurion. And I made that decision, just, you know, snap decision today. And I thought, okay, you brought your own Centurion.
Yes,
so
sir.
Go ahead, you know, and use that. But honestly, I'll be real with you, and I know this sounds cliche because it's real easy to say, but that was just a fun game to watch.
It
Even
was.
Though I knew how it was going to play out at the end, no matter who won, I'd say, here's Comstar, there's your, you know, your, this is what the deal with the devil gets you. But still, like, watching you go, you know what? Sure, you have this ultra-powerful mech. I'm not going to give up. Let's do this. Let's fight to the nitty-gritty. And you just going, okay, well, I have this super powerful mech, and don't take this as an insult, because it ain't, just watching it all fall apart for you. I was just like, oh, God, that's, you know.
Well, and then I think I still could have, you know, maybe pulled out a little better if I hadn't failed that skid with the Grasshopper.
Oh, that was just icing on the cake.
Did you at least have a good time?
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
So you enjoyed it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And you're not just saying that for the camera, right? Like, this is...
Come on, Tuck.
No. Okay. Well, the people at home, they'll be like, oh, that was so OP.
No.
They're just saying that. And I'm like, no, you guys, I try to make these Halloween games fun, even though I already kind of know how they're going to end. You know, I try to do something interesting with it, so... All right, BattleTech fans, that concludes our Halloween episode here at Battlebound. Remember, folks, if you like what you've seen so far, please do us a favor and hit that like button down there and turn on all notifications so you can find out exactly where Battlebound's gonna turn up next. Now, we've had a great time today out here at Dice Addiction Games and More, the home of Battlebound, with our two featured players, and we sure are looking forward to seeing you next time out on the space lanes on Battlebound!
Wanna save your skin, boy? You wanna save your hide? You wanna see tomorrow? You better step aside. Better take a tip, boy. Want some good advice? You better take it easy, 'cause you're walking on the